Hey guys, I just thought I'd do a little tarantula handling video. Bear in mind that I do not handle my tarantulas often. I rarely do it, in fact. So the occasional one I do handle, but before I handle any of my teas, I always test their mood first. And by testing their mood, the best thing to do is to lightly tap their abdomen with your tongs, or some people use paintbrushes because of the bristles being soft. But I'm fine with using my tongs as long as you do it very gently, and just watch the tarantula's reaction when you do that. So this is my Gramostella porteri, and I'm going to lightly touch her abdomen. Now she walked away. Now she's turning around, and sometimes that, in fact, a lot, now see, that was skittish. See, she quickly moved away, and she also turned around almost to face the tongs. So she's not fully accepting of being held today. She's not overly defensive either, but because there's that slight risk of her being aggravated, I'm not going to risk holding her. She's a little more forgiving than some of my other teas, like if I were to test her mood again. You know, slightly touch her. Now she's not too bad, but by her turning around like that, that's a little bit of a warning sign that you have to watch out for. Now, Gramostella porteris are known for their moodiness. One day, they'll be perfectly fine with you picking them up. The next day, they'll bare their fangs at you. So, with any tea, you need to test the mood first. Even if they are typically docile, it is smart to test their moods, because just like people, they have their good days and they have their bad days. Now, some people, when they pick up their tarantula, like to pinch grab their tarantula, and they usually use their two fingers right here and like pick them up. Well, I don't know if you could see that, but they usually pick them up like right there. I don't feel comfortable doing that because tarantulas are so delicate. I'm just so afraid I'm going to hurt the tarantula. So the way I usually do it is I stick my hand like under the, like down low, and I just nudge the tarantula onto my hand. That's how I do it. You know, do whatever's most comfortable for you and what's most comfortable for the tarantula. And so that's the way I do it. Sometimes, you know, I'll scoop them, like I'll nudge them to climb up the glass onto my hand, like that. Since she is in a little bit of a mood, not too bad, but still enough, I'm not going to hold her. But I just wanted to give you kind of an idea. And I'm going to show you what a defensive tarantula looks like for those of you who are new to the hobby, and you'll know definitely not to touch that one. Okay, well, I'm gonna give this one some water and let her get back to doing what she was doing, and we'll see if we can handle any teas tonight. Here's my Lassiodora parahabana, and I want to give you another example of how to test a mood of a tarantula, and when they give you the answer, you'll know how they feel about it. Now, this one already appears to be eager for something, whether it is to escape or maybe it's expecting food. But let's give it a little tap on the abdomen and see what it does. Yeah. Now, did you see that? She just flicked hairs at me. A lot of New World tarantulas rely on kicking their hairs rather than biting. And because the hairs can give you an allergic reaction and cause you to break out in little bumps and hives, and you get itchy and all that stuff. Let's see. Since she haired, you know, see, look at that. See all the hairs there? You don't want to mess with her. She's being defensive by doing that. And as you can see, because she kicked hairs off of her abdomen, she's creating a bald patch on her abdomen. But no worries on that. With the next molt, those hairs will be grown back. So it's not the end of the world. So, I'm not going to bother her anymore. I'm going to fill up her water dish, and we'll move on to a different one. So there's another example of when a tea wants to be left alone. Alright, next. This is my juvenile Formictopus cancerides, and those of you who are familiar with this species is probably thinking, uh-oh, we know how this is going to turn out. But to those of you who are new to the hobby, let's take a look. What's she going to do when I tap her abdomen? Okay, she scampered off. Now you saw that? She gave a very quick threat posture, and she moved away. I'm trying to get her to... Yeah, she's very, very skittish. But yeah, you saw that, her reaction. She's very skittish. She gave a very quick threat posture. And now, I don't want to mess with her too much because look at her abdomen. It's swollen and it's getting dark. So she's in pre-molt. So I'm going to, she buried her water dish, by the way. So I'm going to have to fix that, unfortunately. I hate to, you know, look what she did. She did all this interior decorating, partially maybe to prepare for getting comfortable with the molt. But I need to give her water. So... You know, I'm kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place here. But water's more important, especially when she's in pre-molt. So that's what I'll do. All right, well, we'll leave her alone. I'll just have to, well, what I have to do is to nudge her back in there as much as I don't really want to move her around much, but, you know, I don't want to close the lid on her legs anyway. Now, if you look at her bald patch there, it's still not fully dark. So she's in the earlier stages of pre-molt, so she's got a little more time left. But it's coming, because look how shiny that abdomen's getting too. They kind of get that shiny look also when they're swollen like that. So I'm going to retrieve her buried water dish and up the humidity a bit, and hopefully we'll get a molt from her soon. All right, we'll check on another tea. Now here is my Brachypalma abopilosum. Now brachies are typically, at least the abopilosum and the smithy, are typically good tarantulas to hold if you must hold your tarantula. But like I said, all of them, I will test their mood first. Now the brachies, they do flick hairs, especially the B. smithy and the B. bomi. The B. abopilosum does some, but from my experience, not as much as the bomi and the smithy. But the thing you have to watch out for besides the hairs is that they have a pretty big feeding response. So if you put your hand in there, they might think that's food. So I'm going to, just like with the Gramostola portery, I'm going to test the mood of her and see how she reacts. Now she flinched a little bit, see? Oh, she may not be in the mood. But I don't give up too easily. You know, the first flinch is understandable. Now she usually lets me hold her, which is about why I'm being a little persistent with her.
Okay, she may be okay. Because, see, now I'm nudging her, and she's just kind of moving slowly. So, she may be okay. So, what I do is I put my hand here, and I just kind of nudge her towards it. And as I'm doing that, I'm also watching her chelicerae. Now, sometimes it will happen quicker than you can have a chance to move your hand out of the way. But once you see that chelicerae starting to spread, that's another warning. You better get your hand out of my face kind of warning, or I'm going to bite you. So far her chelicerae is still closed. I'm just kind of scooping her now, nudging, scooping her onto my hand. And you don't want to make any, like, sudden movements either, because that scares them. And there you go. Simple as that. Now, I failed to mention this earlier, but when you're holding a tarantula, it's best to hold them close to the ground. Because if you were to accidentally drop them, or they got spooked and they ran off of your hand and fell on the floor, you could burst their abdomen and then they could bleed to death. So, obviously that would be very tragic, and we wouldn't want that to happen. Now, I want you to look at her chelicerae. Her chelicerae are barely open, so that kind of makes me a little paranoid, but not too bad. She's not too bad right now. She's a little insecure, but she's not too defensive right now. She's just kind of wary. I haven't held her in a while, which is why she's wary. Like I said, I don't handle my teas often, so they don't really get used to me. See how wide her chelicerae is? See that? She might bite. So that's a warning to you guys. See that? Her chelicerae is getting wider and wider. And of course, I'm like, oh yeah, great. But if I were to get bitten by her, it wouldn't be that bad. Their venom is not potent. It would be similar to a bee sting, though, which, you know, is definitely not pleasant, but it's not the end of the world either if you're bitten by a new world this size. Now, if my Theraphosa sturmi were to bite me, the venom would not be potent, but the size of her fangs would be really, really difficult. So, there she is. Yeah, she's cautious. She's just a little on the cranky side. But I think once she gets used to me, she'll get more comfortable. See, she's starting to get a little curious. Her chelicerae appear to be closing. So see, now she's getting more comfortable with me. So there you go. I actually held her more when she was a juvie. She's a subadult. She's probably webbing me right now. A lot of teas, when you hold them, start webbing. I've read somewhere in a book that they do that because it's kind of like their way of, I guess, finding their way back home in case they were to get lost. They just kind of follow their webbing back. That's what I've heard. I don't know if that's really true or not, but it makes sense to me. But she's really sweet. She's just shy. See, there you go. Now, to have her, now I have one hand holding the camera, so I may not be able to show this, but I have her get off of me by pretty much doing the same thing. I just kind of, if I had a free hand, I would gently nudge her onto my other hand or nudge her into her enclosure. So there you have it. I've had her for quite a while now. I think I got her in 2011. And she's about what? About 3.5 inches. So yeah, she's got some more growing to do. They're slow growers, but they sure do have voracious appetites for such a slow-growing tea. See, she's cool. She's cautious, but she's cool. Now I'm worried about her getting falling off of me. She's not an arboreal, so it would be harder for her to dismount, unlike the arboreal. I could pretty much stick to anything. Now, I don't want to risk holding arboreals even up high, but they would be able to handle a fall better than a terrestrial would. See, I'm just kind of gently moving her into her enclosure. But I can see that she doesn't want to go into her enclosure. Okay, you do? There you go. Come on now. Of course, their little, I forgot what you call them, but their little claws at the end of their feet stick to you. So you have to be careful about that you don't pull their leg. But she did pretty well. She had me nervous just a little bit, but she got over it. So I can see she needs some more water, so I'm gonna top her water dish. All right, let's check out some more teas. Well, my Acanthus scoriogenna colada is thirsty. I tell you, she drinks, I think, more than any of my teas. She runs out of water the quickest, it seems. So I gotta fill up her water dish, but wanted to show you what her mood is like. These guys are typically pretty skittish, and she has been known to throw up threat postures, and she flicks hairs. So yeah, pretty much all of the above. So I'm gonna show you what she's like. Very skittish. See that? See, that's what she does. And just like with the brackies, they have, in fact, even more so than the brackies, in my opinion, have a voracious appetite, big time. And so, because of that, they have a huge feeding response. So that's another reason why you don't want to hold these. So I'm gonna give her some water. There you go. So yeah, she will not be held. Even though she's a new world, she will not be held. She's skittish. All right, let's move on to another one. Here's my Phonopalma simoni. This one can be skittish, but as you can see, I'm tapping her abdomen very gently, and she's not doing anything to scare me off. So she may be cool. Now, she is a little on the skittish side, but she would rather run and hide than stand her ground. So let's see if I can handle her. So far, so good. Well, actually, I'm not sure about the sex of the tea. I'm saying it's a her because it's a suspect female. And of course, she's kind of attached to one of her water dishes here. She is a tea that regularly. Now she's kicking hairs, but I don't let hair kicking scare me off that quickly. If especially if they really are pretty docile otherwise. So
despite the hair kicking, I'm going to go ahead and give this one a go. Because otherwise she's not showing any signs of aggression or defensiveness. And she's nervous, obviously. But once she gets used to me, then she will be good. See, Afonal Pomas are actually typically pretty docile. They're great beginner teas, easy to care for, and she's sweet, he/she, but leaning towards a she. See, I can even pet her. See that? She's cool. So yeah, even though they flick hairs, and that's a sign of the being defensive. Other than that, she, just besides being a little wary, she was okay. I mean, you just have to use your own judgment, you know? See, she's fine now. I mean, she's cautious, but she's okay. Isn't she awesome, though? But these videos apparently are turning into filling up water dishes, too. Now, this one here, she topples her water dishes over and fills them with dirt all the time. So I have to really be diligent with this one, because she's always interior decorating. In fact, you know what? I'm getting to the point now where I don't really like these smaller critter keepers, because they're not, like, wide enough. And I want to give her more room to spread out. So I may transfer this one. See how calm she is? Look at that. See, tarantulas are just given a bad rap, you know? They're really cool. They're very, you know, some of them are very sweet, like this one. Look at that. So laid back. Say hello to the people out there. Cool. Alright, well, while she's out of the enclosure, I'm going to kind of spray it down a bit. Not too much, but enough for her to get a drink. And hopefully she won't topple over her water dish too soon. So, we'll end that one there. Alright. Here's the backside of my Triniochilis murinus. Let's test her mood, shall we? Now she very quickly turned that, got in a position to escape if she wanted to. Now, let's kind of move things around and let's see if she's in the mood to be handled. And you saw that. That was a strike. And she's striking at the air right now. And she's still striking. And she's in a threat posture. So when a tea does that, for those of you who are brand new to the hobby, because us folks that have been in it a while, this is old news. But this is what they do when they definitely want to be left alone, and if you even come close to them, they will bite you, no doubt about it. I don't know if you could see that, but her fangs are completely spread, or out, and her chelicerae is completely spread. Her mouth is wide open. And her her legs, her pedipalps, and her first two legs are up. So yeah, that's what they do when they most certainly do not want to be messed with. And that is a classic threat pose. And Triniochilis murinus, the OBT, is known for that. So will I handle her? Definitely not. Alright, let's move on to another tea. Now, if I did this for all of my teas, we'd be here all day. So I just taken a select few. This one here, I decided to try out an Avic. Give you kind of an idea of how they act. Now, this is a little baby, a little sling. And I'm going to kind of... Now, she likes to web her, or he, whichever, likes to web its lid on top of the enclosure, so I always have to be careful when I remove it. But they are heavy webbers, as you can see. This is my Avicularia pulperia. Now, avics are generally docile, but they can also have a very skittish side to them. When they run, they have a tendency, now this one's being pretty calm at the moment, they generally leap about. It's very comical to watch. They have a really cute walk, and when they get excited, they almost leap. Well, I guess you could say they are leaping. But yeah, I got a catch cup ready in case he decides to get adventurous or excited. But let's have this one come out. This is a very, avics can be very fast, very difficult to catch because they are, you know, they're arboreal, and I said arboreals are, in my opinion, harder to catch than a terrestrial. They're not as thick-bodied as terrestrial, so they can move quicker. And plus they have that extra good padding on their feet. Let's see. Now, you probably didn't see that. Well, maybe you did, but she pretty much just leaped out of my hand. See, that's what they do. Now, I think this one could be in premolt, too. Because her abdomen's along the swollen side. But, maybe the earlier stages. But, yeah, they kind of move around slowly like that. And then when they get excited, they just explode with energy and they're gone. And like I said, they are definitely capable of leaping. I mean, these are tarantulas that live in trees. So they can leap about from branch to branch if they really had to. So you can expect them to be a lot harder to retrieve, along with the Poplotheria, when they get excited. But yes, avics are do get nervous, but most of the time they're on the docile side. Now, as John 3800 says in a lot of his videos, personalities do vary. Some people may have experienced a defensive avic, and then others have never had a threat posture done by an avic. So, you know, that's why I always test their mood first before I handle them. And I don't even handle my teas much. See how fast they can go? And that one just leaped off my hand onto the floor. And it didn't have a long leap because, like I said, when you handle your teas, you want to keep them close to the ground. You see that? There was a good example right there of an avic leaping. So I just wanted to show you. They're adorable, aren't they? Alright, well, I've kind of nudged this tea back into its place it likes to stay. So I'm just going to increase the humidity with this one. Avics do like it more on the humid side, and extra ventilation and all that, so I'm going to do that, and then I think we'll end this here. Alright, thanks guys. Hope this helped. What do you think you're doing? I mean, yes, you have that stripe on your underside like a P. regalis, but you're not a P. regalis. You're not arboreal. You're a C. brachycephalus. You need to be burrowed or on the ground. P. regalis wannabe.
Even has a stripe. I think it's pretty cool that they have that stripe like that. I don't know why she does that. It's not like I have the ground moist. They don't like it humid. They like it on the drier side. But she just does that sometimes. That's how she rolls. I'll give you an update on my Pyramidia, who molted recently, successfully. She's hardening up. In fact, her fangs are now red. So I'm still going to give her a little more time before I rehouse her into probably this enclosure right here. So, and let me show you one other thing. I also had another molt. This is my Poclotheria rufolata. Successfully molted along with the P. Arminia. So, doing great. Okay, now I have one more thing to show you. Upcoming. Look what I got. This is a juvenile Theraphosa apophysis Goliath Pinkfoot. Now, this price right here is including the tank. I even got the tank with it and all the decoration. Now the tea, can't really see right now because she's way back there. So I'll give you a better look later. What I'm thinking about doing is putting Large Marge, my Theraphosa Sturmi, in this one, and moving this one to the T. Sturmi's enclosure. I might do that. I haven't made up my mind yet for sure. Just a possibility. But I'm really excited, so I'll show her after she's de-stressed some. She's had a pretty rough day. So, also, it came with about this much of it covered with like tape or whatever, and that is to help keep the humidity inside better. So this part right here is the only open part, because these do prefer it on the humid side. So, alright, so I'm going to give her some water, I hadn't been sexed yet, and I let her just de-stress. Alright, stay tuned for more.